as the scene opens, and I hope all of you children out there have your books open before you, open to Act 4, Scene 1. And you see how he talks to Ferdinand. He has grace. He also has the grace to explain to Ferdinand why he had so austerely, strictly punished you. All right? So I'll read from the text. He tells Ferdinand, if I have too austerely punished, your compensation makes amend. I've punished you very strictly, but I'm willing to compensate you for that. How? Now he's short of Ferdinand. So he's going to give him one third of his life. Who's the one third? His daughter. All right? So earlier, you know, we have heard that he kept on telling Miranda how important she was in his life. Not put ashore colonial power. A brief recap.
Selected Madam Shruti Smita Raha. Ma'am, welcome to our show.
Thank you very much.
First of all, as I have already told that the Tempest Act 4, today we will discuss about it, and I think we will discuss for class 12 only.
Yes.
And I think there's a recapitulation much needed.
Yes. Welcome children to this edition of Lockdown Classroom. This is an effort to introduce you to your play, which you might have forgotten by this time. It's been a long gap since your class 11 and now class 12. Class 12 starts with Act 4. But before that, we'll do a brief recap of class 11 and we'll start at the very beginning. So the play opens with a tempest, and we'll go into how it's a tempest in more senses than one, or storm at sea. The scene, you can imagine, all of you have been to the cinema, so if not to a play, so you can imagine what it feels like, isn't it? If you have a tempest, a movie starting with a tempest or a storm, it creates a sense, it is intense, it's dramatic, and it creates a sense of immediacy. At the end of the scene, of scene one, it seems as if all is lost, and everyone who's traveling on the ship is going, which is caught in the storm, is going to sink and die. But in a subsequent scene, we learn that the tempest was actually an illusion. It was raised by Prospero, the ruler of an enchanted island. So then Prospero was actually the renowned Duke of Milan, who was known for being, and remember, for your ISC, quotations are very important. So when you're talking about Prospero, that he was the prime duke, and his command over the liberal arts and magic was known throughout. We also introduced to Miranda, Prospero's daughter. Now, these characters will become very important in Act 4 also. Father and daughter had been ousted from Milan by Prospero's deceitful brother, Antonio. They had been cast out to sea in a leaking boat. Now, this was Antonio's greatest act of treachery against his brother. Not only did he take away the dukedom from his brother, but he also cast them out to sea in a leaking boat, which would obviously sink. That's what they thought. But fate or divine providence helped them, and they arrived at this island. At that point, the island was inhabited by Ariel, a spirit of the air, and Caliban, who's presented as a subhuman creature, who was the offspring of a witch Sycorax and the devil. Prospero usurped. So the theme of usurpation is coming in more sense than one. Your teachers might have also talked about the colonial aspect here, because remember when Elizabeth, and subsequently when this play was written, King James the First was on the throne, England had become an important colonial power. All right. And Shakespeare very often puts himself into somebody else's shoes. Remember Merchant of Venice, how he put himself into Shylock's shoes so that we tended to sympathize, to understand Shylock's point of view. Here too, it is Caliban, who is the offspring of a witch and a devil. That's what Prospero says. And Caliban feels that Prospero had usurped the island from Caliban. Now, what did Prospero do? The enchanted island had nothing apart from these two. He spent time perfecting his magic, and more importantly, he taught his daughter. Alright, he gave his daughter. Remember, we've already been told that he was a person who was very well known for his command over the liberal arts. Therefore, he gave his daughter an education which was fit for princes. Alright, now there's a method in what he's doing. Now you would wonder why. Why would he give his daughter an education when they're sitting in an enchanted island which is cut off from the rest of the world. Alright, but Prospero has a plan in his mind, and this plan is tied up with his theme of revenge. Alright, he's not going to sit easy. He's going to take revenge, and he's just waiting for the perfect moment. So when Providence brings Alonso's ship to the shores of the island, Prospero gets the perfect opportunity for revenge. He creates the tempest and through the work of Ariel brings the king and his company to the island and distributes them in different groups all around the island. And what did he want? He wanted to bring about a union between Alonso's son, Ferdinand, and Miranda. Now, why Alonso's son? Alonso was a king of Naples and he had helped Prospero's brother Antonio in his plan of ousting Prospero. What better revenge can there be than seeing that his daughter becomes the queen of Naples? Alright, so you can see that he is a man who is totally in command and who is trying to bring things, order things. He's the master puppeteer of the play. He's trying to bring things together to fill his particular mission in life. His mission is to take revenge on his enemies and also to ensure that his daughter gets a place as the queen of Naples. Alright, so we have looked about at this. Ferdinand is not put ashore with his father. It wouldn't have helped because Alonso would have told Ferdinand who Prospero was. So Prospero is cast aside on a nook alone by himself, and Ferdinand believes that his father is dead. Alright, now Prospero effects the meeting between Ferdinand and Miranda. Very much like the films that you've seen, the hero and heroine meet and both instantly fall in love. In fact, Ferdinand thinks that Miranda is a goddess. And remember, Ferdinand is a prince. So he's a courtier. He's seen a lot of women. Alright? But in his eyes, Miranda seems to be the goddess of the island. And Miranda, who's never seen another man in her life, apart from her father. Now, nobody actually thinks of her father as a man. You think of your father as a father. Alright? And she had seen Caliban. Obviously, he's a subhuman creature, not worthy. He didn't have a human shape. That's what we are led to believe. Alright? And so when she sees him, she thinks he's a spirit. And the two promptly fall in love. Now, Prospero is very happy. Alright? Now, one of the aspects of Prospero's character is not only is he omnipotent, that is, he's all powerful, but he's omnipresent. He's present everywhere. In this particular scene, of course, we can see him. Sometimes he just uses his magic to, vanish from the place, apparently vanish, but be there in an invisible form. Now, Prospero is very happy that his plans are succeeding. And what does he do? However, he wants to test Ferdinand. Again, do you see the concerned father? Mm. He doesn't want to give his daughter away to him just because he's a prince. Mm. He decides to test them and to do that, and also their love. Alright, a love has to stand a test. Mm. In most of your great romances, you will find whether it's in plays, whether it's in any kind of form, love has to withstand a particular test. And here the test is, he accuses Ferdinand of being a spy. He tells his daughter that Ferdinand is not as handsome as she thinks he is. And what does she do? He decides to imprison Ferdinand, put him in manacles, give him the roughest kind of food, and also give him the task of piling logs of wood. Now imagine a prince doing that.
Tough job.
Yes. And also, obviously, Ferdinand tries to protest, tries to rebel. He draws out his sword also. But it doesn't help because he immobilizes him. Prospero immobilizes him with his magic. Alright? And Ferdinand and Miranda disobeys her father. He tells her not to meet Ferdinand, but she steals out and goes and meets Ferdinand. And therefore, the love, instead of diminishing, only grows. So love always you'll find in romances. I do not know about real life, but in romances, against obstacles, they always grow. In fact, Miranda even asks Ferdinand, can I lift those logs of wood for you? Remember, she's a young girl, 14 odd. All right. Girls were young and, you know, would be married very young in those days. And she says, can I do it? And he says, no. He says, no, how will I do that? He's a gallant. He's a courtier. So he refuses to do something like that. All right. And then now we come to Act 4, Scene 1. So up till now, this is one subplot of the story. The major plot is, of course, revenge. All right? Yes.
So, ma'am, we have already learned about what is the play in a brief. So,
yes.
Prospero, who is a ruler, as you told, that Prospero is considered as a very interesting figure.
Yes.
But what is the reason behind?
Think of him. He's a magician. Now, today, in our world today, the things he does, probably a scientist does. He controls the storms, he controls the elements. At the same time, he's a scholar. He was well known. He was the prime duke. That means he was a very powerful ruler. Unfortunately, he trusted his brother too much. He's also a very fond father. The fact that he comes to this island and doesn't let it get him down. Instead, he commands all the elements, all right, that they are in the island. And, you know, he becomes the absolute ruler. All this makes him a very, very enigmatic character. Not very easy to understand. Unless, but one thing stands out, and that is his love for his daughter.
Right.
Yes.
And which aspects of Prospero does the present scene reveal?
This scene, it's a very intelligent question. That is because in this scene, we see two aspects of Prospero. We've seen bits of it in the earlier scenes also. We see Prospero the magician. All right. I'll come to that a little later. But now, as the scene opens, and I hope all of you children out there have your books open before you, open to Act 4, Scene 1, and you see how he talks to Ferdinand. He has grace. He also has the grace to explain to Ferdinand why he had so austerely, strictly punished you. All right? So I'll read from the text. He tells Ferdinand, if I have too austerely punished, your compensation makes amend. I've punished you very strictly, but I'm willing to compensate you for that. How? Now he's short of Ferdinand. So he's going to give him one third of his life. Who's the one third? His daughter. All right. So earlier, you know, we have heard that he kept on telling Miranda how important she was in his life. And it must have taken, it's a pang to all fathers to part with their daughters. So here he's giving a third of mine own life, or that for which I live. A very strong statement, isn't it? She is his reason for living. Remember when he was in the leaking boat, even then he had said she had given him the strength to buoy him up when he would have given up. All right. So you see these two aspects of Prospero in this scene. All right. May I continue? Who once again I tender. So once more, probably, he says, I'm giving, tendering, offering to your hand. All your vexations, all your trials, your tests were but my tests of your love. I was trying to test you, whether you truly loved my daughter or was it just a dalliance of flirtation. Now, all of you have seen films again because Shakespeare, I find, was a master entertainer. And this is something that every father will first check, isn't it? When his daughter brings a man she wants to marry to her father, today's situations have changed a little. So the father first tests the man out. Is he the correct man for his daughter? Because, why? Because he's going to give his heart. His daughter, a daughter is a heart for every father. All right, the father's heart resides in his daughter. And you've got a lot of these fairy tales also where the same idea is presented. So he says, were my trials of love, which thou hast strangely, in a manner which inspires wonder. Something strange inspires wonder. Strangely stood the test. Here, before heaven, and now it's a very solemn declaration that Prospero makes. Here, before heaven, I ratify. I'm certainly going to give you this my rich gift, the third of my life, and again my rich gift. He considers her precious. All right. And what happens to Ferdinand? He starts smiling. You know, if you see a father praising a daughter a lot, you are very amused, isn't it? Look at him. What is he doing? And he says, and see how Shakespeare's stage directions are within the narrative itself. He says, don't smile at me, Ferdinand. I'm boasting of her, for you will find that she will outstrip, she will go beyond all praise. You cannot praise my daughter enough, and make any praise will fall short when it comes to Miranda. All right. So, then, of course, Ferdinand, what can he tell Prospero, his prospective father-in-law? He says, I believe it against an oracle. Now, you've come across the word oracle when you did your Merchant of Venice. The oracle was believed by the Greeks to be the voice of God. So even if the gods told me otherwise, I will believe thee. And now he comes to something again, a concern of a father. Also, ideals which were valued during the Elizabethan and Jacobean times. Why do I say Jacobean? Because by the time Shakespeare was writing this play, King James the First was on the throne. So he was writing partly from Queen Elizabeth the First, and then later, this play especially was written during the reign of King James the First. Jacobean is an adjective of James. All right.
Ma'am, I'm just interrupting you. Huh. Maybe take a call.
Definitely.
Yeah. A student is waiting for us from Uttar Pradesh. Michael Shreya Tiwari is over phone. Hello.
Hello.
Good afternoon, dear. Tell me.
Yes. Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Shreya Tiwari.
Yes.
Ma'am, I want to ask that if Prospero was a great magician, can we say Miranda, can we say Ariel as a base of his magic?
Not base, he's an agent. You know, Ariel without Prospero again is nothing. All right. It is Prospero who is the master puppeteer, the master magician. But he has people, his attendants, who do his tricks for him or whatever he does. All right. Thank you for asking that question. So then, as my gift and your own acquisition, you've acquired her, worthily purchased. What you've done, your actions have been worthy. Take my daughter. But. And he says, but. Ferdinand is happy. Now I've got Miranda, and then the word but comes into play. He said, now what, which but? Which condition are you going to place before me? So he says, no. The idea of chastity was very important. Especially premarital chastity was very important in Elizabethan times. So he says, if thou dost break her virgin knot, do not have any kind of, you know, relations with her before the marriage is being sanctimoniously, has been celebrated with all the holy rites. All right? That you must see, this is one of the themes also of the play, restraint. All right, Prospero, Antonio was very, very, he's unrestrained in his lust for power. You have Sebastian also unrestrained in his lust for power. The idea that having a restrained, moderate attitude to life is important, whether it's in love or in politics or whatever. So therefore, he says, if you break her virginity, and the virgin knot would be most understandable to the Elizabethans because the bride would wear a girdle which was tied with a knot, which the husband was supposed to untie. All right? Before all the holy ceremonies may with full and holy rites be administered. So let the marriage ceremony be over. I'm giving my daughter to you, but wait till the marriage. Otherwise, no blessings shall the heavens let fall on you. No sweet aspersions to make this contract, this union grow. But what will be there? barren hatred, sore-eyed disdain, disrespect. Now, these are things that we do not want in a marriage. Disdain, disrespect, hate, and discord, trouble, quarrels, shall strew the union of your bed with weeds. Now, normally the marriage bed would be decorated with flowers. Alright? Now he says, no, if you do not obey these rules of chastity and purity, then, you know, the marriage bed will be covered with weeds of hatred, of disdain and discord. So that instead of looking forward to the marriage, enjoying married life, you'll start hating it. Therefore, pay attention as hymen's lamps shall lead you. Now, Hymen was a Greek god of marriage and he was always shown with torches. Alright, and in the olden days, the bride and groom would be escorted to the bedchamber with flaming torches on either side. Now, you may have forgotten all this, or some of you might have read all this in your wonder tales of Greece and Rome, but the Elizabethans would easily relate to this. What is wonderful is that Shakespeare is referring to these classical myths, being a man who was looked down upon by many of his compatriots as a man who knew little Latin and less Greek. He didn't have a formal university education, as your teachers must have told you. Yes.
May we take another
Yes,
call?
Please, please.
Yeah. Shivam Thapa is waiting for us. He is calling from Dehradun. Hello, Shivam.
Hello. Hello, ma'am. I just want to ask, I didn't understand this paraphrase, ma'am.
Alright, I'll repeat it for you.
Okay.
Good afternoon, Shivam. He says, then as my, what is he saying? He's saying that as my gift, I'm giving my daughter as a gift whom you have worthily purchased. But he places a qualification there. That is, he says that now that you're about to be married, they're not married as yet, isn't it? So, about to be married, let no aspersions, do not anticipate your marriage by breaking her virginity. Have you understood it till here? So, if you do that, he says, the blessings of heaven which should fall on a happily married couple will be withdrawn and your marriage will be marked by hatred, by disdain and discord. Alright? So, therefore, he says, wait till Hymen's torches guide you to the marriage bed. Alright? And Ferdinand assures Prospero. You know, he realizes that this is the concern of a concerned father. He says, as I hope for quiet days. What does he look forward to? Quiet days. What is a marriage of about? It's about quiet days, good children, and a long, happy married life. He says, I want all this. With such love as it is now. And that my love that I have now, it should remain like that. So therefore, the darkest place. Now, why dark? Murkiest means darkest. Because the idea is darkness encourages you to think, to do things which you do not do in the light.
Daylight.
All right? The more opportune, the more suitable place, the strongest suggestion, temptation, that a lower genius, the worser genius is, the belief, the Christian belief that man is made of a higher, some higher qualities, spiritual qualities. He's made up of a baser nature also. So therefore, our baser natures always tempt us to do things which are wrong or which are not accepted. So our worser genius can shall never melt my honor into lust. So he gives his word as a man of honor. And the idea of honor was very important in those days. Alright? That if you give your word as a man of honor, you don't break your word. Alright, so my honor into lust, and so I will not change. You see, there's a difference between love and lust. Lust means giving in to your passions. Alright, he says, I will not do that to take away the edge, the enjoyment of my marriage day. Why should I do that? He says, how shall I console myself? Because he's a young man. So he gets impatient. So he says, I shall think that Phoebus's steeds, again one classical allusion, Phoebus was the sun god. And it was believed that his chariot was drawn by the horses. I will think that his steeds have gone lame or they have been kept chained below the earth. All right, so Prospero then, he's satisfied for the time being, you know. He says, fairly spoke, sit then and talk with her, she's thy own. Now he will not have surveillance. He was always, you know, having, so in today's term, surveillance, yes, very protective about his daughter. And remember, she's an innocent person. She hasn't seen the world at all. She can be led into anything. All right. So therefore, he says, she is yours. All right. Now, do you see that Prospero, we've seen through all these scenes, a very larger than life figure. All right, magnificent, when he must have raised the storm. Remember, Shakespeare was meant to be acted. He was not meant to be read. And today we are reading him, of course, most a pity. And so he, in our eyes, if you were to cast for Prospero, think of whom you would cast. Some actor who was larger than life, not some quiet actor who doesn't have a much of a figure, you know, and things like that. So a man who commands attention by his very presence.
And there are different shades in his character.
Yes, they are. Very, 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 very perceptive remark. There are many shades in his character. And therefore, you know, this humanizes him in our eyes. That, oh, such a great magician, so bent on revenge, but he also wants to ensure his daughter's well-being. And as an audience, I can relate to such a character. This is very important, you know, in any play, that as the audience, we must be able to relate to that character. We've talked about Ariel before, isn't it? That one of the spirits of the island whom Prospero commands. So now he calls Ariel. And the way he calls Ariel is very interesting also. What, Ariel, my industrious servant, hardworking, because Ariel has done all his work for him. Enter Ariel. What? And what does Ariel call Prospero? My potent master. All right. So he says, my powerful master, here I am. And he rewards him for the earlier service, which was another mask-like scene, but which was not technically a mask, the harpies, when Ariel had brought in the banquet in front of Alonso and his group and then snatched it away. So you and your lower spirits, your last service did worthily perform. And I must use you in another trick. So we are going to see another aspect of Prospero's magic, another trick. Go bring the rabble, the crowd of lower spirits, over whom I have given you power. So Ariel is like the supervisor of all the spirits. Here to this place, incite them, urge them to move quickly. And the next few lines are very important. For I must give upon the eyes of this young couple, I must show them some vanity of my art. So he says some trick. I want to show them my magic. All right. Here, Prospero, you know, is a bit of a show off here. I'll show you. You know, I'll show you my
speciality.
Magic. Yes. It is my promise and they expect it of me. They've heard about my magic. Now, let me show it to them.
Okay.
Yes.
May I take another call?
Yes,
there's someone waiting from Dehradun again and it's Pooja Bish. There's their on call.
Yes.
Hello, Pooja.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
I just wanted to know that where Prospero he tells Ferdinand and Miranda that they should not be swayed by their passion
because
of marriage rites are performed.
Yes.
So in some ways, these rites are not given.
Yes. The council is a very perceptive comment. This year we faced this. The council does not recommend any annotation. And if you're big enough to, I think all of you are old enough to read the unedited texts.
Okay.
All right. So Ariel says, presently, you want me to do this task immediately? He says, I, within a twink, a blink of an eye. And Ariel, now Shakespeare's plays were always marked by a lot of songs. And probably Ariel sings this bit. I'm sorry, I cannot sing it for you. Before you say, come and go, and breathe twice, and cry so, so, each one, tripping on his toe, will be here with mop and mow. Each of the spirits will come and with facial expressions. And another aspect of Ariel that we've noticed all through the play, his childlike nature. You know, our child goes to a teacher. Teacher, I've done this. Do you like me? All right. So he says, do you love me, master? No. And And Prospero also is very, very patronizing to him and says, "Dearly, my delicate Ariel, delicate." He's a spirit of the air. So he's not a spirit of the earth. All right.
I'm again interrupting.
Yes, yes, that's all right.
May I take a short break?
Certainly.
It's time to take a short break. We'll be back very soon.
ক্লাস 12 এর সকল মেধার ছাত্রছাত্রীদের জন্য
ক্যান বি ইউজ অন চ্যাপ্টার ওয়াইজ কোশ্চেন ইনডেক্স
ও 2018 সংসদ মক টেস্ট প্রশ্নাবলী সংযোজিত
রাজ ও মার্টিনে
আনসার ফর অল হাইলাইটার এডিশন
বিচিত্রা সহায়িকা সিরিজ
আপনারা দেখছেন এবিপি আনন্দ এবিপি রাখি
শিরোনাম নিবেদন করছে
এলিগেন্ট স্টিল ইন্ডিয়াস নাম্বার ওয়ান কিউএসডি বার সবাই জেনে তাই কিনে
পরিযায়ী শ্রমিকদের ঘরে ফেরাতে সাহায্য করছে না বাংলা ঢুকতে দিচ্ছে না ট্রেন মুখ্যমন্ত্রীকে চিঠি অমিত শাহ অসত্য বলছেন স্বরাষ্ট্রমন্ত্রী দাবি তৃণমূলের ঔরঙ্গাবাদের কাছে মালগাড়িতে পিষ্ট 16 জন শ্রমিকের দেহ ফেরানো হচ্ছে মধ্যপ্রদেশে স্বতঃপ্রণোদিত মামলা জাতীয় মানবাধিকার কমিশনের রাজ্য কেন্দ্র মিলে 10 লক্ষ টাকা সাহায্য ঘোষণা বিমান পাঠিয়ে বিদেশে আটকে পড়া ভারতীয়দের ফেরানোর উদ্যোগ কেন্দ্রের চালু বন্দে ভারত মিশন ইতিমধ্যে দুবাই থেকে ফিরলেন 182 জন দেশে করোনায় মৃত 2,000 24 ঘন্টায় আরো 95 জনের মৃত্যু আক্রান্ত 60,500 দোরগোড়ায় নতুন করে সংক্রমিত 3,320 জন সংক্রমণ মুক্ত প্রায় 18,000 করোনাকে দৈনন্দিন লড়াইয়ে অঙ্গ হিসেবে মেনে নিয়ে চলতে হবে নিয়ম মেনে চললে সংক্রমণ কমানো সম্ভব বলল কেন্দ্র গৃহবন্দী পড়ুয়াদের জন্য সরাসরি বাংলার শেখা ক্লাস চোখ দুপুর 3টে 10 ও দ্বাদশের বাংলা সরাসরি সম্প্রচার একমাত্র এবিপি আনন্দে
শিরোনাম নিবেদন করছে এলিগেন্ট স্টিল ইন্ডিয়াস নাম্বার ওয়ান কিউএসডি বার সবাই জেনে তাই কিনে সহযোগী নিবেদন আনমোল ডেয়ারি ক্রিমার ফর এ পারফেক্ট কাপ অফ টি শালিমার শেফ গুঁড়ো মশলা জীবনের আসল স্বাদ
Welcome back to our program. Ma'am, may you please continue?
Yes. So we just stopped at a very, very critical moment in the scene where he tells Ariel, do not approach. Now he's going to present something before the young couple. As the audience also, I would be very interested to know what exactly he is presenting. So do not approach till you hear me call. So do not present anything till I tell you when to do it. Okay. So here you see Shakespeare also. He was a theater manager. He was a director. He was an actor. He was a writer. Yes. So here also, you know, almost Prospero becomes Shakespeare's alter ego. He's commanding the entire set. Now, those of you who've worked in school plays, you know that there's one person in charge, you know. And that's why he'll tell the others, do not enter till I tell you. And do this and do that. So that's exactly what Prospero is doing. So Ariel says, I understand that. And yet there's that niggling doubt in Prospero's mind. So he says, tells Ferdinand, look thou, be true. All right? Do not give flirtation, dalliance, too much rein, too much freedom. The strongest oats become like weak straw because the blood, when you're young, you're hot-blooded and given to your passions. Be restrained or else forget your vow. Forget your promise. And Ferdinand says, I assure you, sir, I warrant you, I'll put the white, cold, virgin snow on my heart. I'll abate my ardor and to abate the ardor of my liver. Why liver? The liver was considered to be the seat of passion in those days. Well, all right, now he's going to go on to his show, his mega show. Now come, my Ariel, bring an extra corollary attendant rather than want a spirit, appear and portly this soft music. And he says, no tongue. Is magic. If you've ever watched magic shows, in my city, we've got a master magician and who's just next door to the studios here. And this is one prerequisite of any magic show, that is complete silence. So he says, no tongue, all eyes be silent. And what he presents is a mask. If you look at the slide, it's spelled MASQUE. Though, you know, there is a link between this and mask, M-A-S-K, before the young cotton. Now, what is a mask? You've seen a bit of a mask, but a different kind in The Merchant of Venice. Here, masks were a kind of courtly entertainment, all right, which was presented in courts, and it was there during the Elizabethan and the Jacobean times. There were elaborate spectacles with pageantry, elaborate costumes, music, song, and very, very exalted speeches. Then also you would have a lot of reference to classical mythology, mythological characters would be present there. It is believed that this mask was added to the play for a specific purpose. It celebrated the wedding of Prospero, of Princess Elizabeth, who was the daughter of King James I, to the Elector Palatine in 1611, the first recorded performance of the play. Apart from theatre artists, it's believed that during Queen Elizabeth's time, Queen Elizabeth herself also took part in the play. The royals and nobles at court would take a part in these masks. Again, so before presenting the mask, you know, Prospero has, as I've told you, he has, warned Ferdinand about not giving in to his passion. Now, I'll give you a thumbnail sketch of the mask so that you can actually follow it up when school reopens and all of you are there. The mask has three central characters. I've told you that there's classical mythology, three goddesses come down from the heavens, all right? And in Shakespeare's time, and this was possible, why? Because as you all know, Shakespeare performed in his theatre, which was known as the Globe Theatre. But by this time, and it was a rough and rudimentary theater house. You know, you couldn't have a lot of special effects. Now, you are the generation, and here you are used to stagecraft, spectacle. If you had to present this as a movie, you know, the kinds of this special effects. You've got special effects special departments effects. Nowadays. Shakespeare, poor man, didn't have any such special effects, but he made do with what he had. So by this time, it's believed he had moved into a more sophisticated theater called the Blackfriars, which made the producing the performance of this play much more effective. So they used to have a kind of a contraption which would descend from this first floor down to the stage. It would be wrapped in flowers, and it was called, it was just a platform which used to be winched down by machinery, and whoever would come down was termed the Duke Ex Machina, D-E-U-X-E-X-M-A-C-H-I-N-A. A Latin term means God in a machine.
Yes. Take a call again.
Yes, yes.
Isha, Isha Ismail is waiting for us. She is calling from Kerala. Hi, Isha.
Hello, ma'am.
Good
afternoon. Can I ask some questions?
Yes.
Yes, good afternoon. So, my question is not related to the act right now. The question is that, can you give a brief character sketch about the characters in the play? Because that is a question that comes.
Child, that would be a very long, I'd need another session from the ABP, and I don't think they'd be very happy to give me that. But I've done a little bit, if you allow me to proceed with this, and I've done it for one character. If you do it for one character, you know how to do it for the others.
Okay, well, you should listen to us.
Yes. The mask has three central characters. They're actually supernatural creatures, they're goddesses. One is Iris. She's the goddess of the rainbow. All right, the name Iris and the rainbow, rainbow in the Bible, symbolizes hope. And one doesn't know whether Shakespeare was thinking about this when he, brought down the rainbow. The rainbow unites the heavens and the earth. So it unites the spiritual and the earthly. Iris is also the messenger of Juno, the queen of gods. There's also Ceres, the goddess of agriculture, the earth and harvest. And Juno, the queen of gods, of riches, honor, patroness of marriage and childbirth. Do you see the symbolism about the three goddesses, that each one of them have a very important role to play? You know, it is actually, in a way, Shakespeare's Prospero externalizing all the blessings that he wants to give his daughter. All right? And he does it through this mask. Also mentioned are Venus, the goddess of love and passion, Cupid, her son, the god of love, and this or Hades or even Pluto, he's known as god of the underworld. They're just mentioned, they don't appear. Now, therefore, Ceres was associated with, she's the goddess of agriculture, remember. So she's associated with meadows, granaries, and orchards. Now, when Iris calls her, she's at first reluctant to come to the spot if Venus is there. And I've got to tell you a little story here. It's a storytelling time because you won't understand otherwise. Ceres had a beautiful daughter. So goes Greek mythology. Who was known Proserpina or Proserpine. All right. Ceres, as I've said, is the goddess of the earth, of agriculture. It was due to her, the Greeks believed, that harvests grew. Now, Proserpina was her daughter and a very beautiful young woman. Pluto or Hades, the god of the underworld, Otis, as he's mentioned here, fell in love with her. And he wanted her, but Ceres would not part with her daughter. And Hades abducted her, took her to the underworld. And Ceres laid in her grief and agony and pain, laid the earth waste. Nothing grew. You see the relation between life and myths. All myths have some relation to our lives. So nothing grew. Mankind suffered till Jupiter or Zeus intervened, and Pluto was persuaded to give up his bride to her mother. But because she had eaten 4 grains of a pomegranate in the underworld, so goes the myth, she would have to spend 4 months every year with her husband in the underworld. So when she is not there with her mother, the world in winter becomes bleak and cold and nothing grows. When she's united with her mother again in spring, you see that earth becomes bountiful. So Ceres is the goddess of bounty. Now, therefore, when Ceres, of course, when she's called, she first wants to know whether Venus and Cupid are there. Because Venus, I've told you, is the goddess of fashion. All right. And she felt that Venus and Cupid had helped this to abduct her daughter. When she's assured that they are not there, Ceres and Juno proceed to bless the young couple with what? Agricultural plenty, fertility, a long married life, and children. All right. So, why agricultural plenty? What kind of a world was Shakespeare living in? An agrarian world. So, as rulers, shall I say, of the world of Naples, what would they need in their world? They would need this. They would need good agriculture. They would need wealth. They would need fertility. And of course, a long life.
Ma'am, there's another call for us. Rona Kasot is calling from Kolkata. Hello, Rona.
Hello, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, I just had a question which I wanted to ask. Ma'am, my question is that what is the impact of this mask in the play, The Tempest?
All right. Think of yourself as an spectator. Think of Shakespeare's theatre. Think of a glittering spectacle. Think of all the characters wearing their grand costume. Think of the music. Think of songs. What kind of impact would it have had on you? They would be full of wonder, isn't it? And Shakespeare was doing what is today, we call it a command performance. All right. He had been summoned by the king to present it to the court. In fact, the mask becomes a play within a play. So the impact is one of wonder, and that's exactly what Prospero had said. No, he wanted to show them the vanity of his art. I hope you are answered. So therefore, the themes of charity, of chastity, fertility, and unity are reinforced through the mask. All right. So you can see that not only is it a spectacle because Shakespeare had been commanded to present a mask and present a play rather in front of the court, but it is also very meaningful in the context of the play. In fact, the last gentleman who questioned us, he has a reason, perhaps he's read it somewhere. Some people say that the mask is extraneous to the play, but a close reading of the play will tell you that it very much ties in with the main themes of the play. All right. So, yes. No. Iris plays an important role. She is the rainbow. She unites, as I said in the Bible, the rainbow symbolizes hope. And any marriage must have hope. And Ferdinand and Miranda are Prospero's hope for the future. Perhaps, you know, a future in a world devoid of bitterness, devoid of treachery. All right, in a world of in a union which would be an ideal union. Again, a typical fatherly sentiment who hopes for nothing but the best for his daughter. So Iris plays an important role as the rainbow. She unites the heavens and earth, the spiritual and the earthly, the characteristics of a true marriage. All right, which must, involve both aspects of life. The mask presents Prospero's idea of a perfect world, one in nature, in which nature and civilization are balanced. And if you noticed in the mask, or you will notice, there are no evil characters. All right. Before we go on to the sample question, I would like you to just know what happens after this. What is the impact of the mask? The impact of the mask on Ferdinand is that he's full of wonder because he has not actually seen Prospero's magic. So he's full of wonder, but the mask ends abruptly. And this abrupt ending is also very meaningful because the abrupt ending happens how? Prospero is reminded of Caliban and Caliban's plot, which you have read about in Act 3, against Prospero. Alright, and Caliban's plot was a plot to overthrow Prospero by killing him. So what is happening? The harsh realities of life, the mundane, the ordinary, you know, we've talked about our baser natures, all that is impinging on something that's very ethereal, very otherworldly, and the two cannot cohabit. And then Prospero philosophizes, you know, about the illusory quality of life. So the mask itself is an illusion. And therefore Prospero talks about how everything in the world is an illusion and swiftly fading, that it doesn't stay for very long. All right. And then he goes on to punish Caliban and his companions. Now, Act 4 is almost heading towards the resolution of the play because the play proceeds from revenge. All right. Harshness, treachery first. Then Prospero is obsessed by his revenge. You know, he's pretty harsh towards his enemies. And this mask comes as a lull between two very important scenes. You've got the banquet scene before and you've got the last act after. And you've, of course, got Caliban's, you know, demeaning acts. So between this is a little bit of poetic relief where the audience can see something that's beautiful, that's noble, that's graceful. Yes.
And there's another call for us. Shubhono Shane is calling from Kullani.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Good afternoon. Yes.
Ma'am, what is the primary reason for Prospero of arranging this mask?
I would like to quote, he says, it is line 40 in Act 4. It is, I must bestow upon the eyes of this young couple some vanity of my art. I want to show them my skills. It is my promise and they expect it from me. Have you understood it? All right. So it is, what does he do? Why does he do it? He wants to reward them. And like a father, today also we have, if you watch the weddings on television, you have a dance show by some actor. All right. You have some famous band coming and performing. All right. For the bride and the groom after the marriage ceremony is conducted. So here too, Prospero actually presents a show in front of Miranda and Ferdinand. Of course, as you can see, there is a meaning to it because it's not only for Miranda and Ferdinand who are literary characters, but also for Princess Elizabeth and her husband who were very much there. So, you know, you were sort of externalizing what a father might be feeling. All right. So, as I said, and then finally Prospero's revenge takes a break here. For here you will notice that nothing special like happens. There's no action at us as such. Nobody's killing anybody. Nobody's fighting with anybody. It's a scene of great harmony. The only discord being the reference to Venus. children. And towards the latter part of the scene, of course, when we bring in Caliban, then of course there is some amount of discord. And the scene naturally leads into Act 5, where Prospero now, you know, in a way it's a very Christian sort of a play, because it talks about repentance, it talks about forgiveness and reconciliation. And what bigger reconciliation can there be but a marriage? The marriage between Ferdinand and Miranda, which in one way would unite the houses of Naples and Milan. Yes. So may we move on to the samples question?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. But before that, we have another student with us from Uttar Pradesh. Amitesh Dikshit is calling us. Hello, Amitesh.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, my question is, by this scene, we see that Prospero trusts the Ariel. What is the reason behind it?
Why he trusts Ariel? But he's trusted Ariel all through the play. There hasn't been a place where he has not trusted Ariel. Because Ariel does all his tasks. Yes, like a strict schoolmaster, he gets a little annoyed if Ariel steps out of line. But there's never a distrust. He distrusts Caliban. But he doesn't distrust Ariel. Yes? So we move on to the sample questions. And I've again taken, as in my previous classes, the 866 question. Because this 866 is where you score the highest. And I've taken just one component. Because we've been talking about Prospero all through. And I think I'm answering that young lady who had asked me to just give her small sketches of all the characters. Referring closely to the play, evaluate Prospero as a father and as a magician. So you've got your answer. You've got the first part of the mask where you can see Prospero as a father. And you've got the mask itself, the whole spectacle as a magician, which presents Prospero as a magician. Remember, everything is being done by him. So the points that you should be using, his true love from his daughter, and you must not, or you can refer, remember the question says referring closely to the play. So you can start with Act 1, Scene 2, where he says, I've done nothing but in concern for you, my dearest one. All right. Trace the whole, his love for his daughter. Where do you get references? This is where you must read your play thoroughly. And I'm repeating myself, and ad nauseum I say this, that you must read every page of your play, not a guide and not an, a paraphrase. Because the paraphrase does not give you the details. So underline with your highlighter all those exchanges between Prospero and his daughter, or wherever he is referring to his daughter, and see his attitude to her. Early examples will be given of his deep love for Miranda. And also, it's a very fatherly thing that he does when he puts Ferdinand through the test. So all through you will have to, because he tells her that I had raised the tempest, but I have not harmed anyone in concern for thee, because he knew about his daughter's compassionate heart. His concern for the sanctity, for the chastity and purity of his daughter. And then you go on to talk about the mask itself. So there's a bigger plan. He, of course, gives his daughter to Ferdinand. But one wonders, would he have given his daughter, and this is open for debate, would he have given his daughter to Prospero, if he had found Ferdinand wanting in some way? All right? So it's just that divine providence brought Alonso here, and he got the chance of Ferdinand, and he puts his plan of revenge into action, and this particular aspect of his revenge also. Now, Prospero as a magician, you've got to talk about the mask as an example of Prospero's magical powers. All right. And the example of it also refer to his magical powers in the course of the play, starting with the tempest itself. All right. He raises the tempest. It is an illusion. But you and I, as the audience, you know, when you go to watch a magic show, children don't watch magic shows nowadays. But even as children, if you watch, little ones, you know, you completely believe in what the magician is doing. He's pulling a rabbit out of a hat. He's making things appear and disappear. You completely enter the world of the illusion. So here also, when we experience a tempest, remember, we are the audience. We're not readers, actually. Alright, we are the audience, we also feel what is going to happen to the ship, it's breaking, everybody is dying. And then we come to the figure of Prospero standing on a promontory raising the tempest, and we realize that it was a magical act of his. So subsequently, the things that he does, the way he punishes Caliban, all right, the idea that as a magician, his powers were superior to Sycorax, and therefore he could release Ariel, something Sycorax herself could not do. All these are things that you must put in. The entire banquet, which appears and disappears. The harpy's words. And finally, you come to your mask. That is why you must, and I always say this, ma'am, again and again and again, that you must read your play thoroughly to get a comprehensive answer, which will ensure you all your points.
Okay. Yes. Ma'am, another phone call is there. Shomili Hajra is calling from Howrah. Hello.
Hello, ma'am. I'm Shomili Mondal from Howrah.
Okay. Yes. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I have a question, that what is the significance of Ariel's song in this scene?
The song. Yeah, I know many of his songs have a significance. Yeah, probably it was just, think of it as an action, you know, as a dramatic action. His song perhaps gives the actors the time, all right, to dress themselves and to get ready before the mask was to be presented. There's no other significance. And Ariel, and the whole thing that it can be done in the blink of an eye and can be done fast, that is the power of magic. If you ask me to suddenly change from being a teacher here and becoming the anchor, it'll take me a lot of time, isn't it? So you need to be occupied by something else. So this was just a dramatic device on Shakespeare's part.
Ma'am, yes. At that time, what kind of audience he...
This is a very interesting. By the time this play has come, of course, the audience has got a little sophisticated, but the Globe was, and I always say this, that think of any of your master entertainers. Shakespeare was one like that. And he is true for all times. We've just celebrated the birthday of a master bard, an international bard, Rabindranath Tagore, yesterday. Shakespeare was also one person like that. That, you know, whatever he said, we said, okay, we thought the same way. All right? With Rabindranath Tagore also, sometimes I feel everything that I wanted to say, he's already said it. All right? And so also with Shakespeare. His audience was a merry mix. So you had the groundlings, who are people who'd be shouting and yelling, you know, if you had any of your locality cinema halls, now you don't have any of those, the standalones, the ordinary people would go in, they'd make comments at what is happening on stage. You'd also have the young gallants who'd often sit on the stage. In the Globe, they'd come and sit on the stage. He had an apron stage. And then you had nobility and even royalty sometimes coming to visit him.
Okay, ma'am, if there is any homework for them?
Yes. Trace the Ferdinand, because you have, this is the culmination of the Ferdinand-Miranda relationship. So trace the Ferdinand-Miranda relationship in the acts studied.
Okay, so this is the homework. And what is the process to...
As I've told you earlier, as they have done it earlier, in the earlier assignment, you have to trace it right from the beginning, which requires a close and detailed study of the text. Underline all the acts and scenes where, right from the beginning, when they see each other, to Ferdinand's test, to Miranda's pleadings to her father for Ferdinand, the fact that they stay true to their love in spite of all the tests. And finally, Prospero's acceptance. Remember, quotations are highly appreciated, and you also get very high marks for close adherence to the text.
Okay.
And there must be an introduction and a conclusion.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much for such elaborate discussion on the context. And
my pleasure.
Now, we have to give... tomorrow's coming up, and tomorrow, in the same time, you'll have another class of English, but this class is for the ICSE students. Lockdown e classroom aaj e porjonto shob khobore jonno apnader chokh thak shudhumatro ABP Anonde.